The next item of business is topical questions. In order to get in as many people as possible, I'd be grateful for short and succinct questions and responses. And at question number one, I call Rhoda Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government what steps it has taken to protect communities from off-market land sales by so-called green lairds.
Minister Mary McCallum.
Presiding Officer, Scotland's natural environment is going to be absolutely critical in our action to tackle climate change and to avoid ecological breakdown. We are very fortunate to have such potential in Scotland's natural world to sequester carbon, to support biodiversity, and that through woodland creation, peatland restoration, energy generation, blue carbon and many more. This will help us reach net zero, but it's also a real opportunity for our rural communities, for investment and for good green jobs and industries of the future. But I understand that with opportunity comes risk, and that's why I'm seeking to mitigate that with a series of options, including publishing a suite of principles for responsible investment in natural capital. These set out the government's expectations for those who would invest in our land, and including for delivering community benefit, engaging communities and creating diverse patterns of land ownership. I'm also working with Land Commission specifically on the issue of off-market sales and how to avoid that through our actions, and of course developing proposals for an ambitious land reform bill, which I will consult on over the summer.
Rhoda Grant.
The Cabinet Secretary will be aware of these types of sales are increasing and they actually stop communities purchasing their land. It also continues the concentration of land in a small number of hands. The Scottish Government has delayed action on land reform for far too long, and the rush to offset carbon emissions by polluters is now happening, and we need action to prevent it now. It's not in the public interest, and it's not in the interest of our planet. Will she consider ending payment of public subsidies to landowners who do not live on their land or pay their taxes in the UK? This is something she could do now.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the member for her question and recognise her ongoing and long-standing interest in this issue. I would disagree with the point that the Scottish Government has failed to take action on land reform. In our last term, we worked to implement the terms of the 2016 Land Reform Act, which, among other things, included implementation of the Register of Controlling Interests in Land, really important for transparency, setting up the Scottish Land Commission and, of course, the Scottish Land Fund. We will now move to introduce a new land reform bill, which I mentioned I will consult on over the summer. And as regards the last point that Rhoda Grant mentions on the uses of public money and the recipients thereof, that's something that I am considering and will look to include questions on that issue within the consultation.
Rhoda Grant.
The Cabinet Secretary will be aware of concerns regarding food shortages due to the war in Ukraine, yet green lairds are buying land, evicting farmers and using that land to offset their own polluting behaviours. What steps will she take to ensure that land is used appropriately and trees are planted in the right place? What levers will she use to prohibit the arable land and peat lands being turned into forests?
Minister.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Yeah, the question of woodland creation is one that's very important when we talk about land use and land use change in the name of mitigating climate change and ecological decline. And I'm very conscious of the interplay between the need to create woodlands with the need to ensure that we have sustainable food production in Scotland. And of course, we want to make that balance work very well. In terms of tangible actions, I would point Rhoda Grant to the principles for responsible investment in natural capital that I mentioned in my opening answer. And one of the principles therein, which states carbon management should be integrated with delivery of wider environmental, social and economic outcomes, such as biodiversity improvements, resilience to food supply and natural flood management. It's there in black and white. These are the government's expectations of the way that people will invest in our land. This is already being worked on, and as I say, these issues are also being borne in mind as we develop the Land Reform Bill.
Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The drive for net zero is one of the most important political endeavours of our time, but as we know, our SNP, Scottish Government, is resolutely committed to land reform. So can I ask the Minister to expand on how the interim principles for responsible investment in natural capital will ensure that efforts to tackle climate change will work alongside a desire to empower communities and continue reforming Scotland's relationship with the land.
Minister.
Thanks, Presiding Officer, and I thank Jenny Minto for the question, because the interim principles for responsible investment in natural capital are exactly about ensuring that much-needed environmental investment that supports our land reform objectives is responsible and that it benefits communities. The vision of our recently published National Strategy for Economic Transformation is that by 2032, Scotland will be a well-being economy, thriving across economic, social and environmental dimensions. And the interim principles have a really important part to play as early action in that regard. And I quoted one of the principles that related to food supply to Rhoda Grant. And I would just draw Jenny Minto's attention to some of the others, including that investment in and use of Scotland's natural capital should create benefits that are shared between public, private and community interests, contributing to a just transition. Investors and land managers should engage with communities in decisions about land and land use. And when acquiring new land, investors should seek early engagement with relevant local communities to identify opportunities to collaborate. And investors should have full regard to Scotland's land rights and responsibility statements. We will use these principles to now underpin a much wider discussion and to ensure that our policy development responds to what is a very rapidly developing market. And our approach will position Scotland as an innovator in developing a new type of high integrity, values-led market which centres community interests.
Thank you. Question number two, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what contingency plans it has in place should train drivers reject the latest pay offer in light of the reported hundreds of cancellations at the weekend.
Minister Jenny Gilruth.
The temporary timetable that ScotRail put in place is delivering a reliable service, moving around 90% of passenger numbers prior to the current disruption. On Friday and Saturday last week, additional late evening services were added. Because drivers continue not to work their rest days, as is their right and their choice, services were disrupted on Sunday. Now, I know that has inconvenienced and frustrated many travellers. ScotRail will continue to look at what more can be done to improve weekend service availability.
Graeme Simpson.
So there are no contingency plans then. Even if ASLEF recommends members accept the offer tomorrow, it will take 3 weeks to ballot them, so that's nearly a month of disruption to start with. It was carnage on the railways at the weekend. On Sunday, 320 services were cancelled, and there may be more this Sunday. We're in this mess because drivers don't want to work on their days off. Why should they? The RMT's Mick Hogg says it could take 5 years to resolve. Is he right? We could face the same disruption next year, Presiding Officer, but the government rejected a multi-year deal. Why do that? It's crazy. We need stability right now, not chaos. When is the Minister going to deliver it?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm not going to shy away from some of the very real challenges which passengers have faced over the past 2 weeks. But Mr Simpson does need to remember why this is happening. It is action short of an industrial action, but it's nonetheless true to say, as Mr Simpson has outlined, that ScotRail's train drivers have been choosing not to work on their rest days. The rail network in Scotland has been dependent on rest day working for decades. It's not a new invention that occurred on the 1st of April, and it's not unique to Scotland. But it's also worth pointing out that Transpennine Express is currently operating a reduced timetable, similarly at around about 70%. That is as a result of rest day working being banned. And the Northern Train Operating Company, which is directly controlled by the UK government, has also experienced similar disruption this weekend, and that is expected to continue and to increase. Now, ScotRail did make the difficult decision to implement a reduced timetable from last week. That was to allow for greater certainty for passengers. Now, clearly what happened on Sunday was far from ideal, but I am told that because ScotRail did not have enough drivers making themselves available to work on Sunday, it was very difficult to timetable on Sunday accordingly. Now, ASLEF will put the offer to their executive committee tomorrow. I don't necessarily accept Mr Simpson's description that this would take up to 3 weeks to resolve. It could be resolved tomorrow, but that, of course, is in ASLEF's gift, as is the right of trade unions. I'm sure he would agree with that.
Graeme Simpson.
Well, ASLEF is a democratic union, and they will put that to their members, and it will take 3 weeks. That's the fact of the matter. We've had drivers sitting around twiddling their thumbs, itching to get in the cabs at the weekends even. Now, tomorrow, Scotland play Ukraine. The extra 11th-hour services laid on are welcome, but they're no use whatsoever if you come from Dundee or Aberdeen or Perth. But there are other events coming up, Presiding Officer, which also deserve our attention. We've got the Edinburgh Fringe. We've got the 150th Open in St Andrews in July. And what about all those events that are coming up at the Glasgow Hydro? In a couple of weeks' time, Billie Eilish is playing there. Lots of young fans, including young women, who will be going there, wanting to get home afterwards. Does the Minister not think there is actually a basic safety issue here, particularly for young women, and what will she do about it?
Minister.
I thank Mr Simpson for a supplementary question. I have to say, Presiding Officer, we did cover much of his questions last week during Topical Questions. Nonetheless, as I outlined in last week's Topical Questions, there has been some movement in relation to additional services. So, for example, we saw additional services running on Friday and Saturday. We also saw from ScotRail's announcement yesterday that there will be additional services implemented to take fans home to Edinburgh, Stirling, Ayr, Gourock, East Kilbride and Neilston. There was a delay, I concede, in announcing these services from ScotRail. Of course, it is an operational matter for ScotRail, but this was to ensure the timetable was robust and deliverable to give passengers reassurance and certainty of service. And I think it's also worth saying there has been some unclear and unhelpful commentary this week around about final services for fans travelling home to some locations after the game. So, for example, Inverness, the 707 is the last ScotRail train from Glasgow to Inverness on both the full May 22 timetable and the current temporary timetable. So there has been no change to travel options for fans under the temporary timetable. On the Aberdeen service, the 641 is the last ScotRail train from Glasgow to Aberdeen on the temporary timetable. 940 was the last service under the May 22 timetable. Fans would not have been able to use this service after the game. In Dumfries, the 7.13 is the last train on the temporary timetable. 10.13 was the final service on the full May 22 timetable. Fans staying to watch to the end of the match would not have been able to use the service under the full timetable. So, for fans in the north and some in the south, the temporary timetable actually makes little difference. And many of these fans, of course, will be travelling by private bus hire. I'm sure Mr Simpson, like me, would like to take this opportunity to wish the Scotland's men team all the best with tomorrow's match.
Thank you. And John Mason.
Thank you. I mean, clearly everybody would like to have a pay increase that matched inflation, but clearly this is just not affordable. So would the Minister encourage both ASLEF and RMT members to accept the pay offer? Because that will be for the good of the general public, it will help us recover from the pandemic, and it will also help us address climate change.
Minister.
But I would agree with the sentiment of the member's question. Of course, this is a matter for ASLEF to decide upon. The importance, though, of Scotland's railway in terms of our recovery from the pandemic cannot be underlined enough. I think in relation to addressing climate change, we need to facilitate that modal shift to get folk out of their cars and back onto public transport, particularly onto rail. We know that patronage has not yet recovered from the pandemic. I think there's more too that can be done in relation to the cost of living crisis. ScotRail have announced a number of ticket offers recently, and I'm keen that that continues. But we can do very little to take forward our vision for ScotRail, of course, one that's largely shared by our trade union partners who campaigned for public ownership with reduced timetables and fewer services. So I do hope that union members will consider the current offer positively and they will see it as both fair and affordable, and we can all get on and focus on working together to make public ownership of Scotland's railways a success.